Grace and peace be multiplied to you through the knowledge of God and our Lord Jesus Christ. Welcome. Today we'll be looking at God as the living God. God as the living God. God actually used this to describe himself in the Old Testament and the New Testament. When we mention or when we hear the name the living God, what do we think God is referring to? Why does he use that terminology in certain contexts? And maybe God has different names, different titles. It's still the same one true God, but we are looking at him as the living God. Anything living, I don't know whether there's a mystery behind anything living. Living just connotes that when something is alive, and yes, it's breathing, it's walking, it's hearing, it's listening. So God often uses the term the living God when he's actually talking down on idols, on the hidden religion, and which we'll get to as well. He would often refer to him as the living God. The dead gods don't have, they have hands they can't deliver, they have eyes they can't see. And so God uses himself to his people and also to the enemies of God. The people of God will boast against them that we serve the living God that has hands and can deliver, that has ears and can hear, eyes that can see. So we do not serve a dead God. So let's realize it, that though the God we are serving is invisible to our natural eyes, but the reality of his person is more real than anything around us. He created the heavens and the earth. It's not some kind of abstract God. Yes, in a sense, it's remote, but for us believers in Christ Jesus, is remote to the to those who are not his children, but to us believers is indwelling us. So our God is the living God. He's living in us, is speaking through us, is breathing through us. When I mean breathing, is bringing the breath of life into us. So God used this name as a mockery to the dead idols of the Eden, that eyes that have eyes but cannot see, and ears that can hear, hands that cannot deliver. So we often see this term being used by God to, it's a mockery to them, to the hidden nations and that bow before graven images, that hey, where's your God? How come your God can't deliver you like Elijah was doing on Mount Carmel? That look, cry unto your God, the prophet of Baal. And God comes as a living God that yes, is invisible, but we can't deny his reality. What a joy. And for us believers in Christ Jesus, that the God we are serving, the God that we have accepted as our Lord and Savior, the God that is dwelling in us, is living, is the living word, is the living bread, is the living water. Our God is alive. What a joy. God cannot die. What a joy. Today, we are the danger for us as well. Maybe in the Old Testament, it could be seen that, okay, the idols and graven images, they were barren. So, but for us in the New Testament, we are the danger of forming an image of God, not in wood and stone per se, not as if we are bowing. I'm not saying that people are not bowing to that. The heathens are still doing that. But for us believers in Christ Jesus, we could have a concept in our mind and imagination that is neither true nor has life in it. God wants us to be aware that he's the living God. The Lord Jesus Christ, even Peter said, you are the Son of the living God. And the Lord said in John 6:57, as the living Father sent me. So I'm sure that the Lord wants us to be conscious of the fact that God is not remote, God is not distant, God is indwelling us as his children. So let's not have a concept of God as a God. God feels, he's easily touched by our infirmity, Hebrews 2. I mean, God relates with us in terms of he has, I won't say he has emotions because he created all things, but there are times we see in the Bible where the Lord, we could say that the anger of the Lord, anger is an emotion, there is an holy anger as well. So we can see certain things to tell us that our God is living, that when we are touched, just like when Paul saw of Tarsus was persecuting the Christians, the Lord said, look, why are you persecuting me? That's a living God. What a joy. So faith only works with the consciousness, with the awareness, with an experiential knowledge of the fact that the living God that we serve speaks, hears, and acts. He moves, he walks. So it's not just a consciousness that there's a God in heaven, he might hear our prayer. No, he's ever living. There is no place God is not. So this brings life to our faith, that we are conscious of the fact that the God we are praying to, the God we are serving, the God we are praising, the God we are consecrating ourselves to, is a living God. What a joy. He said he has not called the seed of Jacob to seek him in vain. As the living God, he is everywhere. There is no place he is not. So it's not just living, I mean, we are living, I'm living for you to be hearing me, but we are not everywhere. God is far beyond us, far, far, far beyond us. He created us, he's uncreated. So there's no place he's not. The fact that he's not seen doesn't mean that he's not there. He does, though he doesn't manifest himself everywhere, wherever they glorify him, like where people are eulogizing, he manifests himself positively. So God is everywhere. There is no place he's not. And it just takes God, as Isaiah 45 put it, that you are the God that hides yourself, that God opening our eyes to be able to know, to be able to have a sense in our spirit of the nearness of God and the presence of God everywhere. The living God dwells in Christ. So when we are talking about Christ, we are talking about God that is manifested in the flesh. We are talking about the Word becoming flesh. And we see this in the incarnation, that the living God, God manifested in the flesh, he ate with people on doing his earthly ministry. I mean, everything a human being was doing, he didn't have 10 or 12 fingers. He had the same number of fingers humans we have. That is the God that is that is dwelling in unapproachable life, making himself approachable to man in the person of Christ. So the living God is embodied in his children. So today we could say, just like the Lord Jesus Christ in the four Gospels was the living God walking on earth here, today we can say that the living God is in us, because we are the temple of the living God. God dwells in us. God is walking in us both to will and to do for his good pleasure. So the God we are serving, that is the unique thing about the Christian faith, that the God we are serving is not remote of us. It's not a distant God, but is indwelling in us. That's why the scripture say, in him we live, we move, and have our being. Our living God is our ever-present help in time of need. That is ever there. There's no place, there's no situation we'll be in that the Lord himself is not conscious of that fact. And that's what a joy he created the ministry or the gift of prayer for us to be able to pray, that his will be done on our life as it is in heaven. The church of God is the house of the living God. 1 Timothy 3:15, the church of God, the ground and the pillar of the truth. So we go through some scriptures and as to how the scripture uses the term the living. So in the context of the living, we could be able to tell what God is saying. So when God calls his church the house of the living God, that means he's ever present in his church. In every church that the Lord has established, is the living God. Because God is living, the church is also living in him, by him, and with him. So the church of God, any church of the living God, it's not a dead structure. It's not just the four walls of the building. The reason why the church is the church is because it's a living organism, because God dwells there. Imagine a church, for example, a church of the living God that is renting a property. If they relocate to another property, of course, that place doesn't where they were before. It's no longer the church, because the church is a congregation of the saints with God himself. So you can see that the God we're serving is not just a God in the physical structure, but is a church is also living in him, by him, and with him. What a joy that anytime we go to the church, it's like Hebrews 12:22-24, we have come to Mount Zion, the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem, to the company of innumerable angels, to God the judge of all, to the spirit of judgment made perfect, to the church of the firstborn, which is registered in heaven, which is written in heaven, to Jesus, the mediator of the new covenant, and to the blood of sprinkling that speaks better than that of Abel. We are children of the living God. So let's be conscious of that. So of course, we know we are children of God. But when God uses the term believing, he's trying to tell us the fact that he's living, he's aware, he's conscious, he's ever present with us. And I think he's trying to open up our faith to come up higher, to be able to see the fact that there's no situation where we are in where God is not conscious of. We go in the place of prayer. We go in the place of asking for his will to be done. And we go with the consciousness that our living God speaks, he hears, and he also acts. In him we live and move and have our being. What a joy, what a joy. John 6, because I live, you will live also. What a privilege that because our living God is making his home in our heart. Say, because I live, you will live also. What a joy. Because he's living inside of us. He cannot die. And that's why as Christians, we don't die like the heathens of the unbelievers. We just sleep in the Lord when our time, the Lord grants that our time on earth is over. So we can see that because the Lord is living, he lives, we live as well, because we are one spirit with him, we are his body. The living God works in us both to will and to do for his good pleasure. So God is living, God is the living God, because he's working in us. One of the reasons why we say he's living without him working in us, without God working in us, he's still living. But he tells us this in the scripture so that our faith will come alive, our spiritual senses, our faculties will come alive. That look, God that we are serving is working his good pleasure in us. So he must be living in me. And so I'm conscious of the fact whatever step I'm taking, decisions, or whether it's a business decision or what have you, I'm talking with him, I'm relating, I'm communicating with him because I know he hears. Though it might not be with the natural senses, I'm hearing him. Or with my spiritual senses, my spirit man is attuned to him because he's living. What a joy. The living God is manifesting himself on earth through us. So today, we still have the living God on earth. How is he on earth? It's because in us, his children, because we are the embodiment of the living God. We are his house. We are the house of God. We are the temple of him. So he's still working on earth, his good pleasure, but he's embodied in us, his children. What a joy, what a joy that is manifesting himself on earth through us. That's why we are called the light of the world, the salt of the earth. And we are called that the children of God, the sons of God, because we proceeded from God. We are born of God. What a joy. So Hebrews 3, we now go through scriptures that talks about the living God. Not all of them, but at least for the most part, for the most I was able to come through. Hebrews 3:12 warns us not to depart or turn away from the living God. And of course, the book of Hebrews, we could say in the context, was written to a lot of the Jewish brothers, in the sense that they one way had turned from Judaism to the Christian faith, and all of a sudden they were probably weak in their Christian faith. And here comes the Lord writing epistle, I believe it was through Paul, to them, to encouraging them. And the Hebrew context as well is not just to the Jewish brothers as well, because Hebrews means to cross over, but we have a different teaching on that, on the believers, the true Hebrew. But the concept is that they should turn away from the dead religion and turn to the living God. That look, turn away from those dead things, that not to depart or turn away from God, because some of them had, maybe for one reason or the other, their faith was not so strong, and so there was an admonishment that they should not turn away from the living God. Hebrews 12:22 also says that we have come to Mount Zion, the city of the living God, the living God. So God could have said, you have come to Mount Zion, the city of God. But when God is using that term, the living, I think he's telling us that, look, wake up, wake up, wake up. You think I'm distant. You think I'm some kind of, I know you don't think that I'm one of those dead gods, but you are not just aware of the fact that of my power, of my might. Let's not look at God as, okay, he used to walk in the Old Testament and the New Testament. This dispensation is just in heaven. No, God is as active, if not much more active during our time and in the age where we are living at right now. The living God desires a living fellowship with his children. So because is living, anyone that is living wants to communicate to you. One of the things as human beings, we are social beings, we like to relate and interact. No man can just dwell in by himself alone, not talking to anybody. I think that's why one of the punishment they give to those who are probably serving certain who have done some grievous thing in the society, when they confine them to solitary confinement, and it's not always a pleasant, it's a very big punishment. God wants to fellowship with us. That's why I said our fellowship is with the Father and with the Son. So what a joy that the God we are fellowshipping with, the heathens, they bow before a rock, they bow before a tree they can't see that is bigger than them, over a graven image. But the living God we are fellowshipping with is not just a God that is domiciled in a fixed place, is in our heart. So wherever we are, we can commune with him. So how much more, this is Hebrews chapter 9, 13, 14. How much more shall the blood of Christ cleanse your conscience from dead works to serve the living God? So, in many cases, sometimes I think people were feeling, some of the brothers or the young believers were feeling a sense that, oh, the conscience was being smeared. The conscience was pricking them, whether because of their sins and what have you. And here comes the Holy Spirit saying that, look, if the blood of goats and bulls was strong enough to, I mean, temporarily take care of sin, how much more shall the blood of Christ cleanse your conscience? So it's not just the outward, but in the inner being of a person, so that we can serve the living God. That is, we are rejoicing before the ever-living God. What a joy. Not dead work. Christianity is not a dead religion. As someone said, that any religion where God is remote is dead, is a dead religion. Christianity is not a dead. Christianity is a living relationship with the living God. The living God is not a remote God. He indwells us. So the living God is not an abstract, a distant God that is, we are here, is there, is waiting for us to finish whatever we are doing here on earth and join him in heaven. No, no, no. It's much more than that. He's in heaven, bless God. It's also in our heart. It's not a remote. It might be remote to the Old to the old creation, that those who don't have a relationship with Him. But for us as believers, He indwells us. What a joy. We have the address of God, we can say, here on earth here, because God has made His home in our heart. The eyes of the living God runs to and fro the whole earth, showing Himself strong and mighty on behalf of His children, on behalf of those whose hearts are loyal to Him. And I believe, as His child, your heart is loyal to Him. So we should be conscious of this. Anytime we're going out, wherever we hear that the eyes of the Lord is running to and fro the whole earth, the entire earth, He's showing Himself strong on our behalf. So this is why we are always a thanking people. We are full of praises to the living God. We are serving a living God who is not dead. What a joy. And He's not passive as well. Very active, walking mightily, as Paul said, He's walking mightily in Him. So, and this is Zephaniah 3:17. For the Lord your God is living among you, the mighty warrior who saves. The Lord your God is living among you, the mighty warrior who saves. That is for us to be conscious of the fact that the God we are serving is a warrior, is a mighty warrior. He saves mightily. That is, we are divinely assisted. It's not just that giving our life to the Lord Jesus Christ that is the only meaning of saving. It means that in every state we are being saved. We need to be saved from a lot of things, from the work of darkness. We need to be saved from a lot. We need to be God's organic salvation, essentially, God working Himself into us. What a joy, what a joy. As the living Father sent me, let me see if I, hopefully I didn't miss, there was one that maybe we've not gotten there. I think the one of Deuteronomy 5. For the Lord your God is among you who saves. So this was the Lord Jesus in John 6:57. As the living Father sent me, the living Father sent me, and I live by the Father. So the living Father lives. He was living in the person of the Lord Jesus Christ, and today He's still living in us. Ephesians chapter 4 talks to us, one God, one Father, who is in all and in you all. So God is walking in us His good pleasure. God is living. He now says, so he who feeds on me shall live by me. So if he is living by the Father, and whoever feeds on him will live by him. The joy for us is to feed on him, to feed on Christ, feed on his word, feed on himself through our fellowship with him, so that God can be living himself through us. Just like the food we eat, naturally, the expression we make is the function of the food we eat. I mean, it's the food supplies different nutrients and strength for our body to be able to have it, to live. So God is saying that, eat me, and as you eat me, I will live by you. What a joy. So the living God is the living word. The living God is the living word, is the living waters, is the living bread, the bread of life, the bread of God. So it's not just living by, let's put in a context, but he has also given us a medium through which he could express himself in us. That's why John says, the Lord said, I am the bread, the living bread. I am the bread of God. I am the bread of heaven. So that God could live through us, the living way. What a joy. The living waters, out of their belly shall flow rivers of living water. The living God is a very present help in time of trouble. A very, very present help anytime, because there's nothing that happens on this earth that God did not foreknow of. So when things happen, we just rejoice in the fact that He's going to work it together for our good. What a joy, what a joy, what a joy. For who is it? This is Deuteronomy 5 I was looking at before. So who is there of all, for who is there of all flesh that hath heard the voice of the living God? So when God is using the term, that is, as the living God, He has a voice. The voice of the living God speaking out of the midst of the fire. So God is describing Himself that, look, I am the living God. I have a voice. That's, I'm almost saying that. Does God need to describe that? Or is it because that who is there, who has that heard the voice of the living God speaking out of the midst of the fire? Deuteronomy 5:26. Let's look at another scripture as well, Joshua 3:10. And Joshua said, you shall know that the living God is among you. Usually when God uses that, is to strengthen His people to be conscious, not to be scared of the enemy. Is among you, and that He will without fail drive out before you the Hittites, all the Jebusites, and what have you. Joshua 3:10. So that the people of God will be conscious. And today, is this relevant? Yes, we need to be. It's very relevant to us. So some might trust in their horses and in their chariot, but our trust is in the name of the Lord. God wants us to be conscious of the fact that the living God is not just among us like a people, but is in us. Today in the New Testament, what a joy that the living God is inside of us. And who is this? This is David as well, to boasting in the living God against the giant. you defy the armies of the living God. So maybe his other brothers or the other soldiers or army in Israel felt like they were just soldiers of the king. And David comes and look, we are armies of the living God. We have weapons that you can't see that are invisible. Our living God is ever with us. So I think God wants this to sink in us. Even for me, for you, whatever business, whatever career, whatever calling you are in, no matter the kind of obstacles and challenges that is trying to hinder the move of God there, but we can pray and say, Lord, you are the living God, and the living God manifests himself mightily. What a joy. My soul, this is David here, test for God, for the living God. This is Psalm 42, 2a, that my soul is not just testing for an abstract God, a remote God, but for the living God. He said that whoever tests should come to me, John 7:37-39, that on the last day of the great feast, Jesus cried, whoever tests should come to him and drink, for out of their belly shall flow rivers of living waters, which is himself, in a sense, is the living water, is the living bread. What a joy. Also, Jeremiah 10:10, for the Lord is the true God, he is the living God and an everlasting King. At his wrath, the earth will tremble and the nations, and you can, I mean, it's like each time, it's almost appear, not each time, but usually most of the time, God uses the time, the living God, is to just give us confidence and encouragement, and at the same time to strengthen our faith in him, that look, don't be afraid of those nations, don't be afraid of those circumstances. I am the living God. I have eyes I can see, I have ears I can hear, I have answer that can even deliver. What a joy, what a joy. Also, Hosea 1:10, you are sons of the living God. That is, let it sink into us that I am a child of the living God. 1 John 4:4 also say that you have overcome, that greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. And this is our victory, even our faith. We are of God. We proceeded from God. We came forth from God as his sons. What a joy, what a joy. Of the living God, the living God that can never die. What a joy. And Simon Peter answered and said to him, I think it's Matthew 16:16, that you are Christ, the Son of the living God. That is, you are Christ, the anointed one, and the anointed one of the living God that is everywhere. So it almost could mean, I could say that anytime we use that word, the living God, we are saying that God, you are everywhere. You are ever living. There's no place where you are not. As David said in Psalm 139, if he goes down to the region of the grave there, even in the region of darkness, that God is still even there. He can't hide from him. So we should be conscious of that fact that we are serving the living God, the church of the living God. We are the children of the living God. Mark 12:27, it's not the God of the dead, but the God of the living. This was the Lord Jesus Christ. That look, you heard, because they were asking him that, look, someone got died and lost her husband and got married 7 times to the brothers. And the Lord said, look, God is not the God of the dead. God is the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Actually, in the New Testament, we rarely see those terminologies. What we see in the New Testament, that's a different topic. Maybe God by his mercy will show us more. We see the God of Abraham, the God of Elijah, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob used a lot of time in the old. But in the New Testament, what we see is just the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. What a joy. What a joy. What a joy. So it's not the God of the dead, but the God of the living. What a joy. And Acts 14:13, and saying, Sirs, this Paul, why do you do these things? We also are men and preach unto you that you should turn away from these vanities unto the living God. So here in the New Testament, it's often used, the living God, to say that people should turn away from idols and to serve the living God, that our body is the temple of the living God, that look, turn away from these vanities and have your eyes on the living God, because a lot of those vanities, they're just graven images Satan gave to them. For as much as you are manifestly declared to, this is 2 Corinthians chapter 3, for as much as you are manifestly declared to us, the epistle of Christ ministered by us, written not with the ink, but with the spirit of the living God. The living God has a spirit, the voice of the living God, the word of the living God. What a joy that we are the epistles of Christ, because we are being ministered to by the spirit of the living God. What a joy, what a joy. For what agreement has the temple of God with idols? 2 Corinthians chapter 6, also 1 Corinthians 3 as well. For you are the temple of the living God. So when God is using that terminology again, the living God is trying to wake us up that, hey, I'm alive. And he said, I'm he that was dead, that is alive, that was dead, and there I'm alive forevermore in Revelation chapter 1. So we are the temple of the living God. Temple is where God dwells, the tent, the dwelling place of God. In the Old Testament, it was a physical structure. In the New Testament, our bodies is the temple of the living God because we are members of the body of Christ. What a joy. And 1 Thessalonians 1:9, and you turned to God from idols to serve the living and the true God. So God is saying, let's not think idols in this day and age is just confined to struck graven images. Idol could be things that is taking the place of God in our hearts. We could turn things to idols in a sense. Some could turn social media. I don't mean those who are doing business or who use it as a means of business for whatever they're doing to add value to humanity. But when it becomes some kind of an obsession, the phone could be an idol. Even, I mean, the gifts that God gives to people, like the Israelite, the gold that they got from Egypt, they turn it to an idol. So let's not turn away, like we said earlier, the second slide or the third slide, that in this New Testament age, let's not think it's a wooden stones and wood alone that is an idol, but many things that doesn't have life or truth in it. So let's be conscious of the fact that idols is not confined to graven images, that we are, and which is the context of the book of Hebrew, that we have our eyes, we should not depart from the living God. 1 Timothy 4:10, for therefore we both labor and suffer reproach because we trust in the living God, who is the Savior of all men, especially those that believe. I ran out of space there. So the living God, the living God, the living God. So I wake up in the morning and the living God's eyes are ever open. Said I will look unto this, for where comes my help? My help comes from the Lord who made heaven and earth. He will not suffer my foot to be moved. So this is just a joy to us. What a joy to be children of the living God. That we are not serving a dead God. We are not serving a God that is remote, but a God that is everywhere. His eyes runs to and fro the whole world. 1 Timothy 6:17. Charge them that are rich in this world that they be not high-minded, nor trust in uncertain riches, but in the living God. Because the riches as well could turn to an idol. So you can see the context that is often being used. That look, don't have your eyes on things, even the blessings that God gives. God blesses with children, and some people can turn their children to be an idol in a sense. Not that they are worshiping it, but it could take the place of God. It doesn't mean that God is saying that the only thing we are doing is just spiritual things, but whatever we are doing, whether parenting, whether in our businesses, we bring in our A game, we bring in diligence, we are doing those service unto the Lord, that we are serving the Lord himself. So we don't see it as something distinct. Whatever we are doing in life, our walk of life, riches that God has blessed us with, we should not see it as something that is separate from God. As believers, it's a service unto God. Whether I'm producing a movie, it's a service unto God. Whether I am into the plumbing business, an engineer, a lawyer, a politician, a legislator, and someone in the entertainment industry, it's a service unto the Lord I'm doing it, a living God. What a joy. And in Revelation 7:2, and I saw another angel ascending from the east, having the seal of the living God. What a joy for the living God. Revelation is a mysterious book itself, the revelation of Jesus Christ. So today, as well, summary, we do not serve a dead God, nor our God is the living God. We do not serve, Christianity is not a dead religion. Our God is the living God. Today we've been able to look at the fact that God as the living God. We said God often uses this terminology as the living God as a mockery to the heathen nation, to the fact that the heathen nations have gods, woods and stones, graven images, hands that can deliver, eyes that can't, eyes they have it but can't see. But to him, he's the God that delivers. And often he uses this term a lot in the scriptures so as to encourage his children, so that we'll be conscious of the fact that we have a God that is touched with, who can sympathize with us. A God that is not just abstract, but a God that also manifested in the flesh, in the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. The faith, we said, comes with the consciousness of the fact that God speaks, God hears, and God acts as well. For the living God is everywhere. There is no place he is not. Wherever we are, let's be conscious of that fact that God is omnipresent. There is no place that God is not. And it just encourages us. No matter what the giants might look, the challenges, the obstacles, we are boasting in the living God, just like David was doing to Goliath as well. That he comes to him. Who is this? Defying the armies of the living God. What a joy. The living God is not the remote God. He indwells Jesus us. What a joy for us believers in Christ Jesus that the God we are serving is the living God, ever living in us. In Him we live and move and have our being. He's making His home in our life. What a privilege to what the Lord Jesus Christ has done for us. Hallelujah to the Lord Jesus Christ. Praise the Lord. God as the living God, God the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah.